Good morning, good morning. So happy to be in the house of the Lord together today. Let's stand and sing the Passion of our Savior.
Across the leaves, no question. As I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible.
If you can relate to that. But I'm reminding myself, especially this weekend, that I don't have to be adequate by myself. I just have to know that God chooses to use me. He chooses to use all of us in what he's doing. And that just makes it like all the worries go away, because it doesn't matter what's going on in my life, God chooses to use me. I'm trying to hyperventilate here. I'm a little nervous. anyway. So we know that it's his breath in our lungs. He is the one giving us life. He's the one sustaining us through every day, through whatever's going on. And so our response to that is to sing that breath back to him in praise. So let's do that today.
journey. I'm so glad you're part of this service today. Wherever you are in life or in your walk with Jesus, I'm just very, very glad you're part of this service and hope it is a blessing. Hope it's a gift to you in your journey with Jesus. I want to put a couple things on your radar that I believe will be helpful for you as you engage journey and what Jesus is up to in and through us. The first is, if you're a guest, if you're kind of exploring journey, if you're asking questions like, how do I get plugged in, or you want more information, we'd love to have a very brief interaction with you following this service at the Discover Hub in the lobby. And there'll be a team member there just ready to answer your questions, ready to engage you at whatever level you may want or desire. And we'd more than anything love to get a gift in your hand and some helpful information as you explore journey and then you seek to take maybe a next step here. So visit the Discover Hub in the lobby after this service. One of the ways we worship together, we've been singing together, we've been looking to Jesus, we've been worshiping Him. One of the ways we worship together is by our giving. And our giving, our financial giving, really fuels the mission and the vision of helping as many people as possible live in a life-giving relationship with Jesus. In Deuteronomy chapter 16, in the Old Testament of your Bible and of my Bible, it says this, that no man should appear before the Lord empty-handed. Each of you must bring a gift in proportion to the way the Lord your God has blessed you. I love that idea about giving in proportion to how we've been given to. And we get to return the tenth, the first tenth, we call it a tithe, back to Jesus to be part of what He's doing in and through His local church. And so there's multiple ways you can give today, but I just want to say thank you for your generous giving to the mission and the vision of what Jesus is up to at Journey. One final thing I want to put in front of you is the opportunity to respond to Jesus through baptism. And if you've never taken the step of baptism, your next step is coming up next week, August 13th at 9:15 and 11 a.m. We're excited to baptize multiple people and hope that if you've never taken that step, you'd take advantage of that and be baptized. You'd respond outwardly to an inward decision to follow Jesus. So you can visit the Discover Hub in the lobby to find out more information to get plugged into the step of baptism, or you can visit thejchurch.com/hub. We can't wait to celebrate baptisms next week. If you've been here over the last few weeks, you know we've been traveling through the Gospel of Matthew, looking at Matthew's account of the life and the ministry of Jesus. And I've so appreciated these last few weeks as we've sought the scriptures together and opened them and heard from Jesus through His word. And we're going to continue that today. And to do it, I'm really excited to introduce you to my friend, Gabe Hartfield. Gabe is the young adults pastor at Crossroads Church in Grand Rapids, and for a lot of years was heavily invested in God's work and kingdom work at Davenport through InterVarsity and through discipling people in their faith and reaching people for the gospel. And so I'm really excited to have Gabe here with us. Gabe is a fantastic preacher. Gabe is funny. Gabe is a great storyteller. And more than anything, Gabe is a dedicated, passionate follower of Jesus. So would you put your hands together? Would you give Gabe a round of applause as he comes to share God's word with us today? Let's welcome Gabe.
Yeah, so good to be with you. I hope I live up to what Joel introduced me as, but it's just fun to be here. I was a part of Journey for a long time, and I have just loved coming back each summer to share, and Pastor John has just been a great mentor to me over the years. In my family, growing up, there was a sin. Okay, there was something that if somebody did, it was almost considered like an unforgivable sin. And this thing that if somebody did, what it was is my family was really big into movies, TV shows, stories, and books. And if anyone, if they saw a movie first and they spoiled the ending, I mean, this was like game over for them, okay? It was just like, that was something that you just don't do in our household. And I remember one time, like, my mom was really into a book series, and the last book in the book series came, and so I took the book quick, read the last page, and then when I thought I was going to get in trouble once, I just blurted out the ending to the story, okay? Not going to tell you how the rest of that goes, but another time, there was a neighbor who came over, and my dad was going to go see the movie Titanic for the first time, and she had seen it already. And my dad said, don't say what happens, okay? Don't say what happens, because I'm about to go see it. And she just blurts out who dies at the end, okay? And he was just devastated, okay? There's certain times where there's films or movies that you really are invested in, you really care about, or if you're a sports fan and like you taped the game so you could watch it later and then someone sends you the score, you're just like, oh, I wanted to see that. I wanted to live in that tension. When I look at Matthew chapter 10, which is where we're going today, there's an interesting part at the start. So it starts in Matthew chapter 10, and we've been working our way through this gospel, and the last few weeks, Caleb has been sharing about the Sermon on the Mount, and today we're going to Matthew 10, and at Matthew 10 at the start, there's a spot where it says Jesus calls his 12 disciples. Now, if you look at this part, it says, and he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these: Simon, who's called Peter, Andrew his brother, James the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. And all of a sudden, as I was reading this, I was like, okay, Matthew. Just from one person to another, my undergrad was creative writing. If you're going to have tension in a story, don't give it away right there who's going to betray him. Like, you want them to live in that suspense for a little bit. I was like, why would you do that? So he brings this up right at the start and just kind of leaves it, just hangs it out there. Now, one of the things, though, that I like about this passage that I think is kind of interesting is just before this, at the end of chapter 9, the chapter just before it, it ends with Jesus saying to his disciples, to his followers, he says, the harvest is plentiful, therefore pray to the Lord of the harvest to send laborers out into the field to be a part of this labor to gather the harvest, right? And so he says that to them, to pray for this. The next chapter turns around and opens with him saying, look, you guys are the answer to that prayer. I just said to pray to send out people. You are the answer to that. And I'm sending you out as part of this harvest to gather. And so no sooner was the prayer prayed than it was answered. And Jesus sends them out to be a part of this. And I wonder sometimes, like, are there times where we're praying for something and God's saying, you are part of that answer. I am sending you out to go do this. And he sends them out, and he gives these instructions. Now, the last thing that Caleb was talking about was kind of his Sermon on the Mount and talking about the gospel of the kingdom, right? And then he gets to this, and he sends them out. And basically, this sermon is his instructions. So if we look at the instructions here that he gives them, verse 5, these 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel and proclaim as you go, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, what does it mean to say, to proclaim the kingdom of God is at hand? Well, again, what we shared about for the last couple weeks was all about the kingdom and what it looks like to have this gospel of the kingdom, this culture, and to live it out. And Jesus is basically saying, everything that I shared on the Sermon on the Mount, now go and share with other people. Everything that John the Baptist and myself shared about the kingdom, now go and share with other people. He's basically saying to bring that forward. It sounds a little bit like this word that we call evangelism. Now, what's interesting about the word evangelism is sometimes it has some connotations to it. Sometimes people actually don't like this word. In fact, I found this fascinating, but there was a study done by a group called Barna recently, and Barna said that 40% of Bible-believing Christians said that they believed that evangelism was morally wrong. 40% of people who claim to be Bible-believing Christians actually think that it's wrong to evangelize. Kind of seems interesting. Why would we think that it's wrong if Jesus said to go do it? Is there fears around it? Is it something we don't feel like we can do or there's pressure to do? Why is it that people don't like that? And I think part of what I've been wrestling around, like if I just invite you into my head for a second, and what I've been kind of thinking is sometimes I've been wondering, is it possible that maybe Jesus had a different idea of evangelism and a different idea of sharing our faith with others than what we currently think? Is it possible that the way and the method that often we do things is not exactly how Jesus did it? Is it possible he had something else in mind? Well, let's look a little bit further at his instructions and what he tells them to do. If you go to, verse 8, he says, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying, give without pay. So he's giving them this authority. But then he says, acquire no gold or silver or copper for your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for the laborer deserves his food. And I think what's interesting about this part is Jesus gives them like a packing list for your journey. I don't know if anybody's like a camper or likes to go on trips or stuff like that, or likes to travel, has the travel bug, but often you have a packing list, okay? And the packing list, you're like, okay, gotta bring a few changes of clothes, gotta bring toothbrush, all that kind of stuff. Jesus is like, no. Don't bring two changes of clothes. Don't bring extra money. Don't do this fundraising campaign before you go. Just go. And in fact, the less you bring with you, the better. Travel light. And I'm kind of was confused by this because I was thinking in my head, well, if he's sending them out, wouldn't it make sense to have resources to give to people? I think one of the great hurdles, one of the biggest hurdles to modern day evangelism is that we often go thinking we're the ones supposed to always bring something, or we're always coming with a posture that we are the ones giving. And Jesus actually says, yes, give, but you also need to be able to receive. Sometimes I think we think that only way to do ministry is we have to go and give to other countries or to inner city or different things like that. And Jesus is saying, actually, you can also receive. I have a friend who one of the things he regularly does is he sometimes, like when he sees people downtown that are experiencing homelessness, he'll actually, if he needs some change, he'll ask them for money. And he says that one of the things he found is it gives them dignity as a person, and that I'm not always just doing handouts towards them, but I'm also somebody who can receive from you or ask them for advice, ask them to pray for you. Sometimes we need to put ourselves in a posture to receive and not always come thinking you have to give before going. The other thing about it is this, in that ancient Middle Eastern culture, it was something where it was like a culture of hospitality. So if you were going to go over to Israel, even to this day, I've had this too when I was over in Israel, our tour bus was traveling and we were going to the next spot and the bus stops. Our tour guide gets out and he has a meal with somebody. And we're kind of waiting in the bus and like, we gotta get to our next site. But their culture is all about hospitality. So you couldn't go into this next place or enter into it in an honorable way without stopping to have a meal with somebody. I think sometimes what happens is we exclude the idea of hospitality when it comes to sharing our faith and thinking about how to do relationship with people, how to host them well, how to allow them to host us well. And also, this idea of traveling light and having less, I think it's interesting because I feel like for Jesus, emptiness is actually just a place to receive. And sometimes the areas of lack seem like those are the building blocks, those are the raw materials and the ingredients God uses to build bridges to others. That sometimes, maybe, like, is it possible that the areas of need and areas of lack in your life that you feel discouraged by, that those actually could be what God could use to build bridges between you and someone else, if you'd be open to that? Well, Jesus doesn't just say that the areas of lack and need are where he can use for building his kingdom. If you go down to verse 16 here, he says, behold, I'm sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to the courts and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. And I think it's interesting because he's not just saying the areas of lack are spaces God can use, but he's also saying when there's persecution, when there's rejection, when there's conflict in your life, God can actually use that. And I think it's interesting because verse 18, it says to bear witness before them. And another version of this same passage, another translation of the Bible, puts it this way and says that this is actually what will give you a platform to speak into their lives. That when you're put before them and you have to give testimony, it gives you a platform to share. Paul in Philippians, he's in prison and he says, what they thought was imprisoning me actually has given me a pedestal. It has given me a platform to preach the gospel. And so I love that because sometimes the hard circumstances actually can be what God can use. And then listen to this. He gives some kind of odd advice in verse 19. He says, when they deliver you over, do not be anxious of how you are to speak or what you are to say. Now, I was, you know, prepping for this sermon and getting all my notes ready over the past few weeks and trying to research this passage. And then as soon as I came to that part and it said, don't even think about what you have to say next, I thought, you know what? I'm just going to wing it. I'm just going to finish the sermon without doing any more prep. And then I realized, well, the context is when you're being under persecution, when there's the conflict there. And he's saying, don't prep what you're going to say next in those moments. I think there probably is some wisdom in prepping what you're going to say before you say it, like if you're giving a speech or if you're talking to somebody. But he's saying in those moments, particularly, don't think about it. There's something about just being present in that. But I get it, because there is a lot of fear when it comes to public speaking. I think it was Jerry Seinfeld that made the observation. He read a study that said that for the average person, speaking in front of a crowd is their number one fear. Speaking in front of a crowd is their number one fear. And I thought, you know, this is amazing, because I do this every now and then, and this is like a top fear. Number two is death. And so Jerry Seinfeld said, like, how can death be number two? Because that means for the average person, if they have to go to a funeral, they'd rather be the person in the casket than the one giving the eulogy. Now, I don't know if that's all true, but it is something where I've noticed that there's a huge fear of embarrassment or rejection. And I think that this is like a fundamental thing, because like even if you look at history, in ancient times there was this idea that they would say death before shame, right? Like it's better to like, they would say like almost die before like shaming your family or the embarrassment. And I don't know, like sometimes I can feel like there's a fear of like rejection or embarrassment, and sometimes we're not sure what that's gonna do, right? But the thing about it is, Jesus says here at the end, he says, for what you are to say will be given to you in that hour, for it is not you who speak, but is the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. And I think what can happen is this: if we come to a place where when it comes to sharing our faith or being around other people, that we rely only on our own strength, our own charisma, our own personality, we run two risks. We run the risk of, if it does work and the person becomes a Christian or they come to church, then we'll feel like it was out of our own strength and think that that's what did it. And it might build a sense of pride. If it fails and the person doesn't receive, then all of a sudden we might feel like we underperformed or beat ourselves up and think we didn't do a good enough job. When in reality, Jesus says, if they reject you, they're not even rejecting you, they're rejecting me. And if they reject me, they're not even rejecting me, they're rejecting the one who sent me. And I think Jesus is trying to get us away from trying to depend and rely on ourselves. And I love this part in one of Paul's letters. He says in 1 Corinthians 2, he says this, and my speech and message were not with plausible words. Another one version says, not with eloquent words. but in demonstration of the Spirit and power, so that your faith would not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. And so often, we think we have to have it perfect and have a slick presentation. And the thing about it is, in reality, sometimes even if you fail or if you stumble over your words, that actually could be what allows someone to see God working through you and to see that the imperfections are actually what allow God to show brighter through you, because we're not really supposed to be pointing to ourselves. It's not as much about the one who sent as it is about the sender and their God's message. Because if we focus so much on ourselves, we will live with so much anxiety and feel like so much is on us, when in reality it's much more on Him. And we need to trust more in His ability to lead us than even our ability to follow Him. And when we think about like the anxiety or fears that can be produced by this, Jesus addresses those. If you go down just a little bit, He says this, let's see here, and I think verse 28, He says, "And do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear Him who can destroy both the soul and body in hell." And He's saying, look, if you're going to be afraid of people, all they can do is harm your body at most, or like, you know, embarrass or cause rejection. But it'd be better to have fear of God, who actually can do more than that. And He's saying that don't be afraid of these people. And then it says, but you don't even need to be afraid of God, because verse 29, it says, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father? But even the hairs of your head are all numbered." Like, God knows the number of hairs on your head. And if a bird, like if a single bird can't fall without God being aware of it, how much more you? He says, "Fear not, therefore, you are more valuable than many sparrows." God values you, and He knows what's going on in your life. He knows your health. He knows all about you. He knows your relationships, down to the very hairs on your head. He knows everything about you. So don't be afraid. He knows everything about you. And I love this, because it frees us up from having any fear of what the consequences of taking steps for God are, or anything like that, or sharing our faith. It frees us up from fear. And then it gets to a part and says, "So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven." Those are pretty serious words. Have you ever had a time where you knew that you wanted to say something, and it was right and it was good and it needed to be said to somebody? Maybe it was a friend that you saw a pattern in their life that was harming them or others, and you felt like you needed to say something. Or you were in a conflict and you needed to voice it to somebody else what was going on. Or there was somebody that needed encouragement. Or there was something that you knew you were supposed to say, like in your gut, you could just tell it was there. But you relinquished in fear and you didn't say it. Or you knew you wanted to take that step and share about your faith. It was in a like a conversation at work or in school or in college, and all people were talking about something, or in a friend group or with family, and you knew you had that tug that you should say something, but you didn't. I had a few times like that. I can remember in college, in school, there was a few times with friends where people were talking about something, and in me, I could just sense, say something. But I couldn't do it because I was risking what they would think. And if they thought maybe I was judging them, or they thought that maybe I was this uptight Christian that was religious and legalistic, and that they would exclude me from their friends group. And so I didn't say the thing that I knew I was supposed to say. I think we've all had those moments. But Jesus says, "Whoever acknowledges me before men, I'll acknowledge before my Father. And whoever denies me before men, I'll deny." And those are pretty strong words. And I think that when, you know, Matthew's writing this, I feel like at the start I mentioned, you know, Judas, it says, who betrayed Jesus, and I felt like he gave it away. I probably would want to have a conversation with him and say, did you just spoil the whole tension of this? story? Did you give away the ending? And I think Matthew would respond and say, no, I didn't actually spoil it because I already assume people know that. That's not even the main tension of the story. And be like, well, Matthew, if that's not the tension of the story, then what is? I think Matthew would say that actually the tension of the story is not which of these disciples would be faithful to Jesus or not, but you as the reader, you are one of the disciples. And you're supposed to ask yourself the question, am I going to be faithful to Jesus or not? Am I somebody who would acknowledge him? Or would I be somebody who would deny him? And if you read the rest of the gospel, even people who denied Jesus, like Peter, there was grace for that. Jesus even brought him back. But the question and the tension is, what kind of story are we going to live? What's our journey going to be? And I think that when it says that, it makes me think of, there was a time where I had a friend in college who I met who was from Japan. His name was Messiah. As best I can say, that was how he said his name was pronounced, Messiah. And he grew up Buddhist. And over again, I would talk to him about faith. And I would usually say, on a scale of 1 to 5, where are you at with your faith? And, you know, 1 being not a Christian at all, 5 being like, not only do I believe in God, but I have a relationship with God. And he'd usually say a 0, okay? Now, after talking with him for a while, he actually said he was here, like 3. And I was like, okay. And so we were talking and having conversations about faith. And I remember this one time where he needed to be dropped off at the bus station because he was going to take a bus to Chicago. And so we drive down there. His bus leaves at 10. And so we get there at about 9:40. And I'm like, okay, we're here. Let's get you to the bus. And so he gets there and he says, oh, no, I didn't actually print the ticket. I just printed the receipt of the ticket. And I'm like, okay, well, let's go and talk to the clerk and see if we can get the ticket because we're here a little bit early. So we get out of the car and we walk inside. The clerk's office is closed. And so we're like, uh-oh, what do we do? So we go, let's just go talk to the bus driver. Go out. We don't see no bus. And so there's no bus there. And we're like, okay, what are we going to do now? And he's like, I'll call the bus station or the bus place he got the ticket from. So he calls them, can't get through. Finally gets through to somebody. It's almost 10 o'clock. And he says, hey, I don't actually have the ticket. I just have the receipt. And they're like, well, the bus should have been there a while ago. Are you sure they're not there? And he said, yeah, I don't see any bus for Chicago. And they're like, well, when the bus driver gets there, just check with them. And he hangs up the phone, and I can see it in his face that he's kind of panicked and a little bit frantic because he's not sure what to do, like if it's going to happen or not. And I all of a sudden felt that little tug in me to say, let's pray. And so I thought, and just when I was about to say, let's pray, all of a sudden in me, I was like, well, wait a second. If we pray and nothing happens, then he's going to go back from here to here, and he's now going to have evidence that God isn't real. And so all of a sudden, I was like, maybe I shouldn't say anything. And then all of a sudden, this other tug, I felt like there was a tug of war going on in me, is like, well, who are you praying to? And all of a sudden, I realized, well, this is God. And I was having this tug of war inside of me and like tug, tug, tug. And finally, all of a sudden, I just blurted out, let's just pray. And he laughed at me and said, pray, and rolled his eyes. And I just said, God, I just pray everything works out. And in my head, I was like, I sure hope everything works out. And I just walk into the bus station, and we're looking around, and we start asking people if they've seen the Chicago bus. And somebody says, Chicago bus? Oh, they were here like 15, 20 minutes ago. They're long gone. They made 2 calls. Nobody was here. They are long gone. And I was like, great. I just pray, and as soon as I pray, he goes back. He's going to go back from here to here. And we walk out. We're kind of discouraged. We're like, what are we going to do? And we're walking back to my car. We're going to leave because I'm thinking maybe, I don't know, we're going to have to figure something else out. I'm going to have to drive him or something like that. And as we're driving, all of a sudden we hear this loud belch, okay? Kind of, I don't know how else to say it, but that's what we heard. And I look over, and there is this woman with a blanket around her. And she goes, are you boys going somewhere special? My friend's like, I'm going to the car. That's where I'm going. And I was like, well, we missed our bus, so we got some time. And she goes, well, if you got a few minutes, would you mind helping me carry my bags? And we walk over, and she's got these bags of like mugs she had bought and some groceries. And I look at him like, well, we don't have anything else better to do, so here we go. And so we pick up these bags, and we just start following this lady at 10 o'clock at night, and we start walking down these dark alleys, and we're like, we don't even know how far we're following her. And she just senses that we're kind of getting a little anxious about this, and she says, it's just a little further. Okay, so we keep walking, and she's like, it's just a little further, just a little further. He says that a few times, and we're like, how far is a little further, you know? And we're walking, and finally we get to this place where there's a shelter where she's staying. We drop the bags off, and she's like, okay, thank you. And we start walking back, and like, well, that was the strangest thing in the world. I don't know what that's all about, but we keep walking back. And as soon as we're getting back, I pull my phone out, and I call my dad, and I say, hey, Dad, looks like I'm going to have to drive him. We missed the bus. And as soon as I said the word bus, a bus pulled in. And it was the Chicago bus. And it wasn't early. It was late. I don't know what the people were talking about inside, but it was late. And he made the connection that if we had not helped that lady, we would have gotten our cars and left and missed the bus. And after that, the next week, he went from here to here. Now, the thing about it is this. In those moments, you don't always know whether or not things are going to work out. It's kind of a risk to just throw it out there. It's faith. But that is what Jesus calls us to do, to take steps. And here's the thing is this. A lot of times, I feel like we can hear stories of someone coming to faith, and we can think, okay, it's just this isolated event, it's this dramatic thing. And because I don't want us to think that, I want us to look at this last verse where Jesus says this. In Matthew 10:42, he says, and whoever gives one of these little ones even a cup of cold water, because he is a disciple, truly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward. And I think this, when I look at that passage, I think it's also the little things. It's not just those big moments. And because I hear a lot of times there'll be pastors who will share stories about how they were on an airplane and felt convicted by the Holy Spirit to share their faith with someone, and then this, you know, whirlwind of fury, this person somehow gave their life to Jesus and they never saw him again, but they did share in that moment. I want to zoom out for just a second and say, even though that story happened in my life, and I share it because it really did happen, I also want to say I had known him for 2 years. And through those 2 years, there was a series of small decisions along the way, intentional small choices of, hey, he doesn't have anywhere to go for Thanksgiving. He's never experienced an American Thanksgiving. So I invited him over to have dinner with my family. We were in need because my parents' anniversary was coming up and we wanted to do a photo shoot and we didn't have a photographer. So we asked him and he did the photo shoot for us. He served my family and got to know my family. There was also several times of bringing up faith and having conversations around him. And even then, even though he prayed with me, I don't think he was really discipled then. He actually moved to another state after we had known each other for a while and met a pastor and was discipled, and he got baptized. And he messaged me and said, Gabe, I just want to let you know that I just got baptized. And I think why I'm trying to say that is because a lot of times we can feel like we've got to chase the dramatic stories. And the thing about it is, if you feel like that, the risk or the fear I have is that you might walk away thinking, I could never do that, or that I have to be extroverted or have like eloquent speech or I don't know, any of those things. And Jesus is not saying that at all. Jesus is saying, just come as you are. You don't need a lot of equipment. You are the equipment. He has equipped you with everything you need to do all that he has asked. You don't have to be a pro at it. I got married 2.5 months ago. My wife, Montana's right here. And so 2.5 months. So we're pros. And the thing about it is, with that, I realized, like, you know, you could wait till you have it all figured out, but then you'd be waiting forever, okay? sometimes you have to step into things and figure it out as you go. And in the same way with like sharing your faith, you don't have to be a pro to step into it. You just have to take intentional steps. And yeah, it's wise to learn things before you step into those things, but you need to just step into it and learn as you go and realize that God has equipped you. And so often through the scripture, there's so many times where God calls people to do things and they are reluctant because they don't think God has equipped them to do it. Moses, he thought he was not a good enough speaker. Sarah thought she was too old. Jeremiah thought he was too young. The guy with the kid with the 5 loaves and 2 fish didn't think he had enough, this little boy, to give to Jesus. Lazarus, he was dead. But when Jesus calls you to do something, he will give you the strength to do it. There's no excuses because you don't need a lot of equipment. You just need to know that you are the equipment. And we always hear this story or this phrase that says, go big or go home. I think in the sense, like when we think of that, we think, you know, we need to do something dramatic or not do it at all, or do it well or not do it at all. And I think Jesus would probably say, don't go big, don't go home, just go. Just go. Don't go big, don't go home, just go. And so right now I want us to challenge us to do something. A lot of times we hear things and we walk out, but I want us to actually take a step on this. And so if you got your phone with you, I want you to take your cell phone out real quick. I'm going to do it too. But to think of somebody, maybe ask Jesus, is there somebody right now in my life that you would want me to share with, or to even just invite them to church, or to take a simple step of just inviting them out for lunch or for dinner or something like that? What would it look like to just have somebody in your life? Because it's not a question of ability. It's a question of will. Will you take a step and invest in somebody? So I'm going to do it too, but I'm just going to give us like 30 seconds to just ask Jesus for a name or two of some people in your life. If you got your notebook, you can write it down there, but I'm just going to do it as well. I'm going to put a reminder in my phone and maybe even ask him, what's a step I could take? And then we're going to close in worship here. Jesus, when you called us, you said to take your yoke, for it is easy and your burden is light. I don't think you were asking us to do something you were not willing to do, to step into things out of obedience to you, Jesus. Not something out of pressure or something weighty, but just to take one step at a time, small steps, and to trust you for the rest. God, would you help us to know that it doesn't have to rely on us, that we don't have to be the ones to do the heavy lifting. All we need to do is take steps. God, would you give us the grace to be able to trust more in your ability to lead us than even our own ability to follow. And to remember it's more about the sender than the sent, and that you're the one sending us. You're the one backing us. That we can rely on you in your strength. In Jesus' name, amen.
Things
things are possible. There's no broken body you can't raise, no soul that you can't save. All things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up. Oh, you can light it up. You've already won a good victory, and now you're seated forever on the throne. So why should my heart fear what you've defeated? I will trust in there's no prison wall you can't break through, no mountain you can move. All things are possible. There's no broken body you can't raise, no soul that you can't save. All things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up. Oh, you can light it up. Oh, God of revival, let hope arise. Death is overcome, and you've already won. Oh, God of revival, God of
walk with him this week. We'll see you next week.